We welcome each one of you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We also welcome the online audience to this service today. And we'll start the service with a word of prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Almighty God, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, how we thank you, Lord, for this wonderful time that you have given us on the Lord's Day to come to meet you in your presence. Thank you, Lord, for thy Son, Lord Jesus Christ, and his humility, because of which we were able to be saved. Thank you for every blessing that we have in Christ Jesus. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you would, your Holy Spirit may engulf this place. We invite you into our midst. Lord, we ask you that you may speak to us through thy word and encourage us and strengthen us by every ministry, every minister that comes here. Lord, we pray for sanctification in the blood of Jesus Christ for everyone that ministers from the pulpit. And also, Lord, that every heart that is being ministered to may be open to thy word that brings life. Thank you for all that have already come, and we pray for those that are still on the way, that you would enable them to come safely and join us. For we ask all these things in the most precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Good afternoon. Welcome back. I'm very fond of saying this, so please indulge me. 7 days without church makes 1 week. So glad to be here. Yeah. There's a word that a preacher once said that I always remember. He said, you know, children, when dad says, sit at the dining table, dinner's ready, they never come to the table and say, Dad, are you sure you have the money to feed us? Are you sure that you can take care of us? You know, it's that kind of trust and expectation that that God our Father tells us to have. That is why Lord Jesus said in the Lord's Prayer, simply one line, which says, give us this day our daily bread. It wasn't just spiritual, it was also whatever we are in need of. This song speaks about how sweet it is to trust the Lord, just to take him at his word. It's a beautiful testimonial song. May the Lord remind us of the Father that he is to us as we sing this song. Join with me.
It is so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust him, precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that He is with me, will be with me to the end. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove in all and all. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him on. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, and in simple faith to plunge me need the healing, cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease. Just from Jesus, simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him all and all. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him all and all. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Amen.
Thank you, David, for that wonderful hymn. Yeah, first I was introduced many, many years ago, this beautiful hymn. Yes, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him. I just want to remind that we are in the presence of the Lord. In the presence of Lord, in the sense, I guess just give you an example. The boss may be very friendly with you, but you cannot do the same thing to your boss. He may put his hand over your shoulder and walk and talk to you. And it was 32 years ago when my boss, he was making coffee for himself. And he asked me, you know, Vijay, how do you like to have coffee? I said, no, I'll take it, because, you know, I never saw in India, you know, a boss giving coffee. So he said, it doesn't matter. Tell me, how do you? So I just, you know, although I used to drink with cream and sugar, I said, black coffee will do. Because I didn't want him to do that. It's the same thing. We are not in the presence of our boss. Because he gave me once, I didn't say, hey, Paul, you know, can you make a cup of coffee for me? I could never say that.
We are in the presence of the Creator, Almighty God. So powerful. He created everything. What you see and you cannot see with just a word of mouth. But look at His love. He made us with His own hands. Yes, we should definitely sing what a friend we have in Jesus. It doesn't mean that while we are in His presence, let us behave ourselves. There's a lot of time for socializing. And if you remember something, you know, it's all right. It's not that important. You would forget it later on. You don't have to talk. Once again, I just want to remind every one of us, we are in His presence. When He is here, we have to behave ourselves. We should present ourselves acceptable to Him. And also already, as you have seen, the verse for exhortation today is on the screen. Morning, I was just going through the Google and asking for the benefits. You know some of them. There are 7 benefits with the sunlight. And there are 8 benefits walking and running barefoot on sand. And there are 10 benefits, surprising health benefits of love. 10 reasons why it benefits being a good human. And I saw hundreds of comments. Is there any benefit to be a human? And some guy says, you know, it is a benefit for human to be a human, so we can kill animals and eat. So that kind of funny comments you see. But when we think about the psalmist, who is David, shepherd boy, in a way neglected boy. All the other sons, they were good in physique, so they were serving the Saul's army. When Samuel came looking, Jesse was showing everybody all big sons who were really in the army and all these things, and he was looking for David. He couldn't find them. He was shepherding the sheep. And God has chosen him right from shepherd. He fought so many good fights, wars. He became the most richest king. Whatever he wanted, he had everything. But now, when he was in that condition, the verse says that 8 in 116 Psalm, "For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from falling." He was in such a condition, but still he says, "What shall I render unto the Lord for all the benefits towards me?" Yes, my dear beloved. Today we are sitting in His presence. We are here to thank Him and praise Him for what all the things that He has done in our lives. Imagine the things that you do not know. Probably when you were born, some of us, we don't breathe. Everybody is worried that the baby may not survive. And you, God, survived. 5 years passed, you're not able to speak. And God has put speech in your mouth. The same thing. If you keep on looking, the list of benefits that God has done towards you, you can't count. You can't count at all. So let us be in His presence the way it it is acceptable to him, not the way that it is acceptable to us. Let us remember what all the things he has done in our lives. We are human beings. We may forget a lot of things, but whatever if we remember. And especially, never to forget. And I am sure that those who are bread-bought children, they would never forget that the gift of salvation that we received through Jesus Christ, through his sacrifice on the cross. The King of Kings, Lord of Lords, he had to leave the heavenly glory because of the love that he has for us. Let us worship him in truth and spirit.
Stand for the worship. We sing, our judge and our defender.
Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Oh, we sing, I believe in yes, I believe you rose again, and I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. Yes, I believe in you. Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints'
communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of, oh, we believe. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is still the Word. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ His Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is free and one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Take the bread of life, broken for all my sin. Your body crucified to make me whole again. I will recall the cup poured out in sacrifice to trade the sinners in for your new covenant. Christ is formed in me. I live in
what you've done and who you are to me. You've been so, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. And hard to think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. And you've been so, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. And all to think where I would be if not for you, if not. Oh, you've been so good. You've been so, so good to me. All the days of my life, you've been so, so good to me. And oh, to think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. One more time. And you've been so, so good to me. And you've been so, so good to me. And oh, to think where I would be if not for you, if not for you, if not for you, if not for you. As far as heights reach from the depths, as far as east is from the west, so far your grace has carried me. Until I see you face to face, until at last I won my race, remind me you're not finished yet. And as far as heights reach from the depths, as far as east is from the west, so far your grace has carried me. Until I see you face to face, until at last I won my race, remind me you're not finished yet. You've been so, so good to me. Oh, to think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. And you've been so, so good. Oh, to think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. And you've been so, so good to me all the days of my life. You've been so, so good to me. Oh, to think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. And you've been so, so good to me. And you've been so, so good to me. Oh, to think where I would be if not for you, 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 God, if not for you. As far as heights reach from the depths, as far as east is from the west, so far your grace has carried me. Until I see you face to face, until at last I won my race, remind me you're not finished yet. Hallelujah. 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 I live in remembrance.
Be seated.
At this time, we'll prepare ourselves to take part in the Lord's table. And then, before we do that, let's look at the Word of God for exhortation. There are so many things that come to our mind when it comes to the Lord's table, but what you see, the main verse, the theme of it is, do this in remembrance of me. And the song that we just read, it so very well defines what we should be remembered, what we should remind ourselves, how good God has been to us. And as I was thinking about it, what normally happens is, humans have the tendency to forget when they do certain things in a repetitive way for a long time. We keep doing certain things and we forget why we are doing it after some time. There are so many illustrations that come to my mind, but even Apostle Paul, writing to Corinthians, in if you look at the NIV version of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 on, he says, "Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you have received, on which
you have taken your stand. By this gospel, you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, he says, you have believed in vain. So again, here is another remembrance. In different versions, it will be different, but in NIV, he says, I want to remind you of the gospel that was preached to you before. And he says that if this gospel has saved you, and it will save you if you hold firmly to the word that I preached to you. Meaning to say that, if we forget for an instance how we have received the salvation, and if we for one moment think that there was any credit that we can give ourselves, if for one moment we discredit God and His Son of the sacrifice and of the love, we may be in the danger of losing what we received, which is our salvation. And secondly, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he talks about verse 15, he says, He died for all, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15, He died for all that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for Him who died for them and rose again. And this is something that we need to examine. And we need to ask ourselves, God has saved me through the blood of Lord Jesus Christ, through the sacrifice of His dear Son, I have been saved because Christ died for my sin. But now that I live, how should I live the rest of my life? And he says that those who live because Christ died should live no longer for themselves, but for Him who died for them and rose again. And that is an examination I think we have to, whether we are at the at this point where we take part in the communion, which is the Lord's table, or whether it be any other time or any other day in our life, it is a constant examination. It is not a one-time thing. On a daily basis, we need to question ourselves as to how we are leading our life. Am I living for myself, or am I living for Him who died for me? If I'm living for Him, does my life look like that? Is there any difference from the way I used to live before and the way I'm living now? Is there a difference? Do I see a difference? Am I able to love the people that I used to hate before? Am I able to talk nicely to the people that I used to talk in a condescending way before? These are self-examinations once we have accepted Jesus Christ, because He died for us. Now that the rest of our life, we should not live for ourselves, but to the One who died for us. Amazing verse that really strikes our imagination to think and examine, especially when we come on this day to the Lord's table. Before we take part, we remember His sacrifice, we remember His love, and as a result, we say, Lord, I have wronged you here, I have wronged you there. My life should not have been like this, but I'm going to correct myself. I'm going to straighten these crooked ways of mine. I'm going to leave my wicked ways. I'm not going to be haughty or proud anymore. I'm going to humble myself. And Lord, I'll live a life that is pleasing to you. And if that is the promise that you made to the Lord, then everyone that is born again, that everyone who has been saved by the blood of Lord Jesus Christ is invited to take part in the Lord's table. And before that, we will read 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 onwards, responsively.
Verse 23, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus on the same night in which he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. But as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, put you in constant till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep altogether. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we once again come into thy presence, to thy table, Lord, and remember the sacrifice of thy dear Son. And Lord, when we take part of the bread, help us to remember that this is the body of our Lord that is broken for us. And when we take part in the wine, the grape juice, let us be reminded that this is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that was shed on the cross for the remission of our sins. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. This time you can maintain social distance and come ahead and take part in the Lord's table. The kids are dismissed for Sunday school. We have, in the basement, we have provision for kids of different ages, so you can send your kids and the teachers will take them. Today we have a guest speaker in our midst, Pastor Jae Lee. He is the pastor of Ebenezer Mission Church in Bayside, Queens. And that is the only introduction he asked me to give it to you, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to tell you more about him. He is a bivocational pastor, has been in some e-commerce business for some time, and now he is focusing more on missions. And he's been here at Crossroads Church before, spoke to the congregation at Crossroads Church, and Jonathan and David have given us feedback about Pastor Jay, and all good feedback. And we hope God really speaks to us today in a new way. So without further ado, I would like to invite Pastor Jay to speak to us with a warm CFLC welcome. Please.
Good afternoon. I really appreciate the opportunity afforded for me today to share the Word of God and really share with you how faithful our God had been. And I'm sure that in your congregation, your church also experienced His goodness. Thank you, Pastor Swarup and Jonathan and David, for giving good words. By God's grace, I've been serving Ebenezer Mission Church for almost 20 years since its founding. And now we grew into, even though it's a small church, three autonomous congregations, Korean-speaking, Chinese-speaking, and English-speaking. And we're, by God's grace, able to plant churches, especially in Southeast Asia. You know, Ebenezer Mission Church, our middle name is Missions. So our focus is on really taking the gospel to wherever God sends us. I'm currently a bivocational pastor, just like Pastor Swarup, and I'm praying to slowly transition to be a missionary. And about 5 years ago, I started a what's called a business as a mission that takes me to many different parts of the world. And in 2019, I had a really unique chance to see Chennai and Bangalore and Mumbai. And there I really saw the need for the gospel. And I'm sure you all know very well. And God has to, and God will move the mountains in India. Amen? India somehow has a very special place in my heart. Honestly, I'm saying this because many years ago, for my first business as mission project, I actually bought and ran an Indian online grocery store. That's when the Patel brothers and Amna Bazaar and this one of now these more major online the companies are they have stores here too, but then they didn't really partake in online. This was probably the oldest, very first, what's called IndianBlend.com. No longer you can search it because I'm no longer in the business. Too much competition. I was squeezed out. And it led me to a different venture, but you know, I've been shipping groceries, Indian groceries, to all the Indian people just come to the U.S. and living in the parts of the world in the United States where they can have easy access to Indian groceries. So I've been shipping a lot of spices and groceries and all those things. I work closely with Patel Brothers and the Abna Bazaar in Jackson Heights and New Hyde Park and also Hicksville. I'm sure you know those stores, right? So I developed this special palate for and love for Indian food, and definitely more than average Korean. Palak paneer, tandoori chicken, chutneys, and tikka masala, and all those things. Biryani, thali, of course. I love those, and also very sweet Indian sweets, jalebi and gulab jamun, and you know, kaju katri, and I love them so much. My mouth is watering as I'm speaking, but the thing is that I've been telling my family actually that I don't know about India, but then I'm still scratching the very surface of what India's country is, but then I told my kids that maybe there's something in the future that God had prepared for me, as God has really been pushing me out into the world more for missions. Somehow I feel like that my path will cross with India. So here I am, and who knows how God's going to use this, right? Our relationship being forced here tonight, today, this afternoon. But I'd like to jump into the Word of God. I'm so eager to share the message that God has given me today. This is the message that really challenged me and broke my heart. And I hope God could do the same with you as well. The background of today's message is, this is shortly after Lazarus' death. Jesus came to Bethany to raise Lazarus from death. And by the time Jesus arrived in Bethany, it's already been 4 days since his death, right? And Lazarus' sister, right, Martha and Mary, along with close friends, were in deep grief. The people are often paralyzed and helpless before the power of death. It was like then and now, and this is where Jesus arrives. When Jesus arrived, Martha tells Jesus, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask." Amen? Even now, God will give you what you ask. I mean, this is a very precious confession. Knowing that even in desperate and impossible circumstances, God can do anything. Yeah, one thing bothers me, however, when I hear this confession. Martha seemed like she offered amazing confession, but there's one thing that bothers me. Martha confessed, I know, instead of saying, I believe. Well, Pastor, that's the same thing, isn't it? Really? You're telling me there's a difference? You know, our faith should be based on not just knowing the truth, but really believing in the truth, to be able to hope and to entrust, even in supernaturals, even in impossibles. So here, Jesus actually challenges Martha, because Jesus, knowing this, challenges Martha. That it's not just knowing, but it is actually trusting, really believing in. So Jesus tells Martha, your brother will rise again. Somehow Jesus sensed that that was not something that Martha had in her heart. And Martha answered again with the words, I know, here again, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Martha again uses the word, I know. And this is where we see more clearly the difference between just knowing and believing in, and that's what Jesus sensed. Because if you really believed in, then your heart will be led to hope in the impossible, something only God can do. But here, somehow, even though she says, I know, and then she has some belief, right? She knew, and she has some belief, but somehow, she did not really trust in Jesus to raise the dead. Of course, it is important to know the truth, right? Knowing the truth leads us to the form of belief system, but one has to also really believe in the truth, not just agreeing and knowing what the gospel is, but to really believe in the gospel. This is where I like to really differentiate between belief and faith. There are a lot of beliefs out there, and there are people who are totally sold into their beliefs. Actually, all the great things achieved by men is achieved by people who really believed in something, right? They believed in something strong enough to change their behavior, change the direction of their lives, right? To be able to live for something, to be able to die for something, give up all that they have, and make huge sacrifices because they believed in something. The people out there in different belief system, they serve different gods, they have very, very strong belief. But there's only one belief. Only one belief. Instead of that belief really driving you, instead of that belief really moves you, there's only one belief. There's only one truth out there that leads you. Surrender on your knees. Fully convinced that there's nothing I can do. There's nothing I can achieve. Nothing really matters that I do. Unless I am totally surrendered before God. And that He knows in my life. And that He knows all things. There's only one belief that could render us totally helpless. So God intervenes.